Harley Williams, and I'm the president today.
Before we get started today, I'm going to talk a little bit about our speakers, but before we do that, a few housekeeping things. If you haven't already made yourself aware of it, we've got pastries and drinks at the back. We'll have a break in about an hour and a half, and at that time we'll have popcorn, cookies, and drinks, restrooms, or my right, your left. Make it casual. Anytime you need to get up and leave, please feel free to do so. Our lineup of speakers today, after Charlie and I get finished anyway, I think it's really outstanding. If you haven't already, please silence your cell phones, especially after Charlie and I finish. You may want all the distractions for us. We have Matthew Pankey and Sam May, our IT experts. After us, we're going to talk about cyber security and an actual live demonstration on how easy it is to hack into the computer system. Then after the break, we're going to have Todd Patrick and Dr. Robert Darling, Todd's an economist. Colonel Darling, as I think most of you have read, is a senior military officer at the White House on 9/11. A really great talk. So we'll give more specific introductions on them a little bit later.
Let's talk about why we asked you to come today and why we invited you. We see we're a community bank and we see our role that way. We think being engaged in the community should be something that we should do. We focus on the community and invest in it. We preach it every day at the bank. We have a lot of employees that are engaged in the community every day. We're local, we're locally owned, we raise deposits locally and we lend locally. So we're pleased that you're here. And thinking locally is kind of job one. We'll talk a lot about it today. Just know that we have a lot of leaders in the room today, and we're thankful that you're here. Our bank can survive, but we won't thrive without you and the communities we serve, so we hope you have a good day. Before we move on, those of you that don't know us, we're going to engage in about 5 minutes of some shameless self-promotion, so we promise it will be quick.
Something like that. 675 charters. Move forward to this year, we're down to 6,269. So you see the number of charters is really dropping. Talk a little bit more about some of the reasons for that a little bit later, but suffice it to say that it is a very different environment than what we opened in. We were starting the bank, and I was going around trying to sell stock. The question that I was asked most was, well, aren't there too many banks in Marshall County? My bad answer was, yes, but there aren't enough good banks in Marshall County. And I think these statistics will bear that out. Just a little explanation. These are deposit numbers just for Marshall County. They're not the best statistics in the world, but it's all we have to go on. The FDIC publishes market share statistics once a year. It comes out in late September, and it says of June 30th in that year. So we don't have 2016 numbers yet of June 30th. So the most current information I can give you is about 14 or 15 months old. And I picked 2006 to start because that was the year that Wachovia bought South Trust and the landscape of Marshall County really began to change. But at that point in time, when we were 3 years old, we had gone from zero to $111 million in deposits. The combination of AMS outreaches was about $385 million. Bancorp South, $207 million, and Wachovia at that time, $271 million. Fast forward to June of 2009, right after the recession, you can see that we had grown another 70 plus billion. The AMS outreach combination had happened by that time, and they were sitting about where they were 3 years prior. Bancorp had dropped pretty dramatically. Wachovia, Wells Fargo by that time, had lost over 50 billion. So the most recent numbers you have, you can see that we've grown another 50 billion, Regions has dropped 50 billion, Bancorp South stayed about even, and Wells Fargo really bottom dropped out for them. Focus is, we think that community banking is great for communities, and you have really rewarded that with us. And we thank you that you're our customers. If you are, if not, we hope you think about doing it. But we, as Charlie said earlier, we exist for our community. We don't get it in the communities we operate. We don't get it. A lot of banks may have decision makers in large population centers. They put all of the resources there. They take the deposits from local markets like ours and put them to work in the population centers, which is not good at all for our economy. And I don't agree with everything that comes out of Harvard, but this one is factual, and I think I agree completely. Just reading it, I know you can read it, I'm going to read it off. But according to Harvard's Community School, community banks account for more than half of small business loan volume and nearly half of commercial real estate lending. It's not an exaggeration to say that the health of hometown economies depends on having healthy community banks engaged in robust, properly underwritten small business loans. Actually, that number is a little bit higher. Community banks make close to 60% of small business loans. In the current landscape, the mega banks in the country have 75 to 80% of the deposits, but we community banks are making 50 to 60% of all the small business loans. And as you all know, that's where all the job creation nationwide is coming. It's not coming from big corporations as much; it's coming from small, innovative businesses. We think we're much closer to the ground to understand what's going on in this market with our borrowers, with our customers. A lot of other people do. One of our goals from the beginning has been to get to the point where we have enough professionals on our staff so that any business in our markets that's going to do anything productive, whether they're going to buy a business, buy some new equipment, expand, change business lines, whatever, will seek our counsel because we have hundreds of years' experience in our lending force of people that have been around in this market. We are local. Almost every one of our employees
We talked about how we see our role. It's not just investing dollars. Or, I think a lot of banks can do that. We don't view that as our primary role. We have initiatives that involve growing financial literacy in our communities. We have employee volunteers, I mentioned earlier. They acknowledge that volunteering is just as much a part of their job as what they do between 8 to 5 or what they do in normal banking hours, which aren't necessarily 8 to 5. We had 17 people at the United Way breakfast yesterday. We have 100% giving from our employee base, so we're active in the community. We had a working functional branch within Governorsville High School. Our Wildcat Tellers are here today, as is Angie Blanchard, a teacher at the high school, our de facto CEO. We felt it was important that they were here today, and we feel it's important to have an opportunity to tie an active branch to a business curriculum in the school. We have plans for 2 more next year, one in Elkmont and one in Albany. You know, like you, I think we support many local initiatives, and not just with a check, but with our people. And we have a lot of resources at our disposal. We're happy to do research for you, industry research or anything we can do to help. We'll run some numbers for you that can help you plan better. We ask a lot of questions. Some of them are good ones. And we might help you shape up an idea that can help you down the road. And we're happy just to talk through a project. As Mike mentioned, we have a lot of employees with different experiences, different levels of expertise. And again, we think it's exactly what we're supposed to do. You saw our numbers a few minutes ago, and it's necessitated some changes for us. The growth of our bank has come to the point where we've tried to go with our current facility as long as we could. Quite simply, we've pretty much just run out of space. We have some employees within the bank that should be co-located that are in other areas, and it's challenging for us. Many of you seen our new facility. We plan to move in between March 1st and April 15th. We tried to design it with a community-centric design in mind. We have an office that's for use just by anybody that might need it. If you work out of your home and you need to meet with a client or a customer, feel free to come use the bank. If you're on the road, you need stuff and do some planning, feel free with that. We have a community room that will seat 50. So if you have training needs or just need to get your management staff together somewhere offsite, we welcome that. And we have a net that's going in above our drive-through, and I'm told we'll hold 150 to 200 people. Pretty darn big anyway, but we'll have community events there, and we'd like for you to avail yourselves of it.
A lot of the banks that I talked about earlier, the 119 that started in 2003, were designed to sell to enrich the incorporated. We didn't do that. We went in with the focus that we were going to run this bank as if we were going to own it for 100 years, and that's still our focus. Not saying we're never going to sell, but that is not our intent. It's kind of funny, but in the last 6 months, I've had two people come to me and say that we were selling to somebody. They were specific enough to have who we were selling to and when the day was going to be, which is ironic because I've never talked to people that we were selling to. And I can tell you that we wouldn't be building this building if we were looking to sell, because it would do nothing but reduce the value of the bank. So we're committed to this marketplace. That's what's happened to a lot of the charters in that 1919 that started. They were designed to sell. We are not. We're trying to create a franchise that can move forward and truly, as the Harvard quote said, be an integral part of helping economic growth in the communities that we operate in.
Well, congratulations. That's the end of our shameless self-promotion. Let's move on to the larger business picture. We've had a lot of things that have occurred in our country, and I wanted to put a slide in that kind of shows everything that's been going on, not just within the United States, but within the world as well. We have in 2010, we've had the European debt crisis. We had the bailout of Greece. We had, in 11, we've had our debt crisis. Our credit got downgraded by Standard & Poor's. In 2012, we had a recession. We had Hurricane Sandy hit. 13 brought us the debt ceiling crisis as the government was shut down for a couple of weeks. 14, we had oil leak in the slide, and it generated some recession in some emerging markets. And in 15, China devalued their currency. They had a small recession themselves. Oil's been getting no better. And just this year, we've had Brexit. We flooding in Louisiana and other places, and we have an uncertain economic landscape that we're working within. And you'll hear some real specifics later, but we've been through a lot. Our economic growth is slow. Some would claim that it's slowing. There are 25 central banks in the world. Only two have raised rates. One is Alred, and the other is the Central Bank of Mexico. There's 12 of the ones that are remaining that are considering easing, and there's 11 that maintain they're going to stay the same. But our economy, while not great, is still better than virtually every economy in the world.
You've heard a lot of this buzzword, the new normal, and we think that is where we are with our economy. We're advancing, so the work of that. That new normal includes regulatory challenges, which have hit all of us. Every one of you know that it's more expensive to do business today than it was a few years ago. I don't know every regulation could go through all of them that you have, but I know we've all been hit with Obamacare. What has really hit us, and I think this is indicative of a lot of others, is the Dodd-Frank bill. It was passed 6 years ago, and over 2,000 pages in it. Since the passage of Dodd-Frank, numbers of bank regulations have more than doubled, and they're not finished yet. We've got two more years before all of the regs will be interpreted so that they can get them out. And that's pretty bad when you've got a bill that takes 8 years before the regulators can understand what's in it so that they can put it out. Bottom line, they don't know what they're doing. They don't know what the regulations say, and we sure don't. We're held responsible for it if they find something that we're not doing right. I mentioned a while ago inflation in Japan. Same is happening here. We've had extremely low inflation. Those of you who are as old as I am know that back in the late 70s, early 80s, inflation was a huge dirty word because it was double digits, and we all wanted to bring inflation out of the economy, which is what happened. But unfortunately, having some inflation is great because it gives pricing power. If you can't raise the price of your goods and services, then if you know that the cost of business is continuing to go up, and that means that you've got to do other things to keep your profitability where it is. You've either got to cut costs, you've got to be more efficient with technology, you've got to grow and spread your cost over a bigger footprint. Whatever it is, you've got to do something, and that grow part is what a lot of you have done, and Charlie talked about that a little bit more. But that's where we come in. We're here to have good local businesses grow and meet the new challenges. And one thing I didn't say on the number of banks, anybody in this room other than bankers, can you guess since 2008 how many new banks have been chartered in the country? I told you between 2000 and 2008 it was over 1,000. Anybody guess how many since 2008? One. And that was an Amish bank in Pennsylvania. It was a specific target market. So basically, the Dodd-Frank bill has created a barrier of entry in banking that is too big to get over. It's too expensive to get into banking, and with the rate environment in there, you can't make enough money. So that makes it extremely tough on us who are already in it to try to be as efficient as we can to keep going.
So what is it we need to think about doing, or what do we need to go over in our minds about what needs to happen in our businesses? First, let me talk about how it impacts us as a banking business. In our world, we make money on net interest margin, which is basically the difference between what we pay for deposits and what we earn in interest on loans. We make a little bit of money on our investment portfolio. We have a limited number of things we can actually invest in, but we hold securities. Honestly, some of the money we currently have in securities is money we'd rather win. We also generate fees, some on services, some on loans, some on deposits, a few from other sources, but collectively this is what makes up our gross income within the bank. I know this won't shock you, but you're probably not earning what you once did on your deposit balances. Through the industry, this was our first line of defense to save our net interest margin. Every loan that was going on the books for a while, we're replacing a loan that had a better yield. And banks in general were battling about how to keep their margins. So the first line of defense again was to begin to cut deposit rates. You know, it's hard for us to pay up for deposits or any institution for that matter, and we can't really do anything with the money inventory in your business. If you have extra inventory, it's sitting on the shelf, you have money tied up in it, you can't use it, you can't convert it to cash, so it's a kind of a dead asset for you.
Personally, you have supported us, and we like to think of you as our business partners, hope you think of us as your business partner, to help you navigate the new economy. We have been up, before the pre-recession, we've been up a little over 200 million in loans. Over the next 3 or 4 years, that number dropped down to about 192 as the economy around here was trying to recover. Since then, we've been able to grow pretty well. We're averaging about 10% a year in loan growth. We're back up over $260 million now. So we appreciate you helping us use up our inventory, as Charlie said. Our deposits, so we can loan it out. That's what we want to do. That's where we make our most money, is when we're lending money.
You know, for us, we have a couple of options about trying to maintain our margin, grow revenue. The first is just to try to honestly make it up on volume, try to make more loans at cheap, even though they're less expensive rates, and we get more gross revenue at the top of the funnel. Secondly, we can, like many of you, pursue other things that might be revenue generators. Our bank doesn't focus on mortgage origination, a fee-based product. That's also a focus on investment and wealth management that drives fees to the bank. Some banks have chosen to go to entirely new areas. They might be aggressively pursuing consumer lending. They might look at prepaid cards for the fees that they offer. They might look at a factoring business or maybe even a full-fledged asset-based lending business that has capital costs with it, but grows loans at better margins. Some of those will do well. And some of them will find themselves so far away from their core business that it will challenge them down the road. The third thing we can do is we can just cut costs, try to eliminate overhead and personnel. Not something we're trying to do in our bank. We value our branch network, we value our employees. But you often see this when you read about a large bank that's closed 200 branches or something like that. And that's really just an effort to eliminate overhead and eliminate personnel. We can also reduce costs by growing, either by merger or acquisition. We might mention the Dodd-Frank Act, the compliance costs we all face, and if we are allowed to spread those things that lend themselves to consolidation over a larger asset base, it works well for us. We've actually used the last few years to train our employees, to improve our staff, to build better teams, and make sure that each of our employees kind of understands the importance of their job as it relates to our overhead performance. Our overall performance. We feel like we're in a long, slow growth economy. So we must absolutely evaluate everything that we can do, decision by decision, not different for most of you. Honestly, we just have to be better in the environment we're in. We have to be better bankers, better business people, better managers. And right now, it's just important that we keep that focus.
We talk about the recovery being the longest one in the history of now, but it's been uneven. We've certainly seen it in our marketplace in home building for the first 3 or 4 years of our recovery. You didn't see any new homes going up. Right now, there are a lot, so that's recovered some. I guess the biggest thing in the uneven recovery would be the petroleum market. A couple of years ago, we were $100 a barrel. Before Charlie said, prices crashed, went down to 25. You probably all heard the story in North Dakota where you can make $15 an hour flipping burgers. Well, now you probably don't have anybody eating those burgers because those oil wells are basically shut down up there. But at best, it's been a challenging recovery. Some of you are as busy as you've ever been. Some of you are struggling to find business. And it's just not felt like it's been business as usual with us.
So what does this look like for you? We talked about how it looks like for the bank or for the banking industry. We all face fierce competition that, as Mike mentioned, has taken away some pricing power for us. My view is that we've actually perhaps imported some deflation over time. Once we had a robust economy that was growing 4 or 5% a year and it could bail us out with some things if we made a mistake. I read a Wall Street Journal article recently that likened the economy to dangerous curves on a racetrack. In good times, and straightaway, the right power will carry you through, but the curves that we're facing now actually require some finesse. And we don't all see the track the same, and we don't all have the resources to deal with it as effectively as we might. And Southwest Airlines is actually a good example of a company that really changed its, the nature of what they do. Their rivals began in tough times to cut routes and to cut capacity. Southwest viewed as a time to really lower rates. They picked up a tremendous amount of market share, and now they're a huge player in the industry. We have companies that started in the slow economies, and we just need to stop pulling our horns, hunker down a bit. Let's avoid making any real strategic decisions. Let's avoid capital investment. And I think this has gone on so long that many of them are beginning to wonder if that was the right strategy. They're paying heavily playing catch up right now. With our bank, you know, we went through 2008 and 2009, when times were slow and we kept seeing a yield curve that said rates are going up in 90 days, rates are going up in 180 days, so just stay short and wait for the economy to catch up. Well, there was a point where along the way we said we can't afford to do that anymore. We have to make money now, and we began to work on changing the nature of how we invested. We changed the nature of our own portfolio, changed our balance sheet, and we've been fortunate that we did. As Mike mentioned, this has dragged on for so long, I don't think we'd accomplish nearly what we could have. Now, on the other hand, there have been businesses that have a tremendous amount of success that they've used the economy just to slow down a bit, to right-size their balance sheet, to make the strategic investments. In fact, there are people in this room that have used the past several years to go out and acquire technology and acquire new equipment. And it's allowed them to gain market share. They're the low-cost producer in their industry. They don't have to be the low-cost provider, but they can compete well if they need to. Now, we've seen others that just got back to focusing on what they did best. Reinforce their core business. They've clarified their activities. They've basically chosen where they wanted to play. And they've distinguished between what's a core activity and what's a less vital activity that they may need to share. And a lot of times that involves a customer by customer review of profitability. Who helps you in your business and who doesn't? And then you have the challenging conversation about what do we do with those clients. Many businesses have simply spent time investing in their people and not just their senior management. They've invested across the board, and now they have a much deeper group of individuals and employees to help them make significant decisions. Manufacturers have had it particularly tough, especially those that are looking for talent. We've got an entire generation of people that have been raised to pursue service jobs. And I think how do they tell the story of the fact that they have interesting work that's challenging, that can be profitable and offer a long-term career, people that are walking by every day and not noticing what they had to offer. I'll make a quick comment on millennials. Speaking from experience, I'm blessed to have one. We don't always agree with them, but they've come up so digitally that we have so much more information on them than we've had on any previous generation. So we understand their habits and their wants and needs. I've come to the conclusion we're going to think they're who they are, and for us to sit back and wait for them to grow up and adapt to the real world, I think it might be a long wait, and perhaps it's really us that needs to do the adapting. But they're already the largest component of the workforce, and it's not going to slow down because they're also the largest part of our population. You know, one thing, sir, I think we don't all have the same perspective on race. We're just different people, and it's just the facts. Some choose one route, some will choose another, and neither of them will be wrong. It just fits what we're trying to do. You know, at our bank, we're constantly evaluating if we're going to how to best embrace technology and innovation. There's a lot of neat things out there that look like they might be good, and some of them we're going to let somebody else pay that road for. On the other hand, we can't resist it either, because there are also companies that know that the technology that exists can help them in the long run, but they're just unwilling to suffer that short-term give-up in their revenue stream that it takes to adopt that technology, and it's a challenge for them. You know, partnering with others is something that's really coming on. People fear it. There's a loss of control involved in it. But particularly with things like technology and now with compliance, it's something that people are having to really sit down and think hard about. We can't wear every hat in our business. And finally, the experts in the industry making a great differentiator today is something they refer to as organizational agility. And it really surrounds how quickly can you execute on a decision? How flexible are you? Do you understand the barriers that exist in your business? We all have them that keep you from being able to get from point A to point B as quickly as you'd like. And they've determined that the companies that do that the best are the ones that are most successful in the world we're in. Now, we can talk talk about all these things, but it's impossible for us to stand up here and give you the perfect recipe or game plan for your business. Everyone here's got their own business model. There are a ton of industries represented here. And there's a thousand other variables, not to mention that we all perceive the risk of it. But in the type of economy we're in, I heard a good quote Sunday at church. I'm sure it was meant for me, but it has application to business. And it's that we can get so busy focusing on the urgent things and the pressing things in front of us that we're missing the important things that we need to be doing to grow our business. And I think just right now, I guess our message is that we just have to be on top of our game the best we can. We're in a long run here that may challenge us, but we just got to work smart.
Charlie mentioned the fact that we had to change our view of what interest rates were going to do. And many of you are facing similar challenges of when you're going to invest in technology. Can we wait? Can we put that expense off? Excuse me. One interesting statistic for the banking industry is that there has been more money lost by banks in waiting, keeping their assets short term, and the money that they've lost in opportunity cost by investing long term than was lost in all the credit losses during the recession. Just think of that. That there's a real cost sometimes to waiting, sometimes it's a great thing to do. But anyway, that finishes mine and Charlie's presentation. We do have a few minutes for questions. Anybody has any?